Blackstone Audio presents The Teapot Dome Scandal, How Big Oil Bought the Harding White House and Tried to Steal the Country, by Laton McCartney. For Rye Ryan. Author's note. In the interest of full disclosure, I should mention that my family benefited from some of the ill-gotten gains accumulated from the Teapot Dome affair. In 1935, my father, Frederick Laton McCartney, then going into his senior year at Yale, spent the summer in Europe. By the time he got to Paris in late August, my father was flat broke. Desperate, he called the only person he knew in the city, Harry M. Blackmer, one of the chief participants in the oil swindle, and asked for a loan, explaining that he was Fred McCartney's son. At the time, Blackmer was living in exile in Paris with a $10 million teapot windfall and his mistress and later second wife, a Norwegian opera singer named Ada Norena. A former resident of Denver, Blackmer had often played golf with my grandfather, but as a wanted man, he was leery that my father might be an FBI agent or a journalist. "If you're Fred McCartney's son," he asked, "how would your father play the 13th hole at the Denver Country Club?" My grandfather was a champion amateur golfer and the designer of the golf course in question. He was also left-handed, which meant that his game, and in particular his strategy in playing the 13th hole, differed from that of right-handed players such as Blackmer. After my father, a golfer himself, explained how Fred Sr. typically played the 13th, Blackmer gave him his address and asked him to come right over to his apartment. There, my father enjoyed a lavish dinner and drank champagne with the old rogue and his Norwegian ingenue, while Blackmer pumped him for news from home and later presented him with $150. That was a sizable sum in 1935, more than enough to sustain my father until his ship departed a few days later. Part 1. Harding. 1. A Reversal of Fortune. Ardmore, Oklahoma, November 21, 1920. The oil king of Oklahoma came back to the Randall Hotel and flopped down on the bed in room 28 without undressing. It was just after 6 p.m. Jake Heyman had been drinking most of the afternoon. He needed a nap if he was going to make supper. Clara Heyman was in the adjoining room when Jake came in. She listened as he dropped his keys and change on the bureau and collapsed on the bed. She and Jake had been together 10 years. They shared the Heyman name, but were neither married nor related. A few months after they met, Jake had paid his nephew, Frank Heyman, $10,000 to marry Clara and then sent him off on the first train to California. The marriage had been a blind. Jake wanted Clara for himself. Sharing the Heyman name made it easier for them to travel together, registering in hotels as Jake and Clara Heyman. Jake had left his wife and two children for Clara. A clerk in a dry goods store, Clara had been 17 at the time, 18 years Jake's junior. With her wavy brown hair modestly done up, her deep blue eyes, and her reluctance to wear rouge, she looked more like an attractive young schoolteacher than Jake Heyman's mistress. After they met, Jake offered her a job, sent her to stenography school, and took her out to the oil fields with him when he'd been wildcatting on the Osage and up in the Panhandle. Clara was smart and every bit as ambitious as Jake. For the past few years, she'd been acting as his business partner and advisor. "He was a masterful man," Clara said. "He dominated me from the first time I looked into his eyes and noted the strange glint in them." Now Jake had hit the big time, the jackpot of all jackpots. Not even in his wildest dreams could he have imagined the good fortune that had recently befallen him. Until 6 months ago, Jake had been a big fish in a pond that was far too small to accommodate his vast ambitions. The oil king of Oklahoma, the newspapers called him, the raucous, hard-drinking Heyman, had graduated from the law department of the University of Kansas, then set off for Indian Territory, present-day Oklahoma, where he clerked in a store in Newkirk. When the Kiowa Comanche country opened up to settlement, Jake went in with the first rush of new settlers to Laton, then an Indian town. Over the next few years, he had been named Laton's first city attorney and chairman of the Oklahoma Republican Territorial Committee, made money building a railroad with John Ringling, the circus impresario, and then got into oil, where the real money was. With the 1920 presidential election coming up, Jake decided to gamble almost everything he had on backing a long shot in the 1920 Republican presidential convention, Senator Warren G. Harding from Ohio. Heyman borrowed nearly $1 million from the National City Bank of New York, today's Citibank, using his substantial oil holdings as collateral. He took his bankroll to Chicago and spread his money around where it counted, buying delegates and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.